Well, praise the Lord. It's that time of week again. It's time for another radio broadcast. We're grateful for this opportunity. We mention that each week, and we're thankful for it each week as well. Amen. This is the Bear Trail Baptist Church broadcast. We certainly are privileged to be the pastor there, Brother Tim Krotz. And we're grateful that you're tuned in today. We do hope the Lord will help us and use us to be a help and a blessing to you. We've been studying Psalm 23 for several weeks now, and we have many, many, many more to go. I hope you do not despair. This is a great psalm, and I will never be able to do it justice, but I want to take my time and go through the psalm as well as I can, and I pray that the Lord will use the sermons to be a help and a blessing to you. So we'll continue in Psalm 23, verse number 2 today. I think that's where I'm at. I make all of these. It appears to you that I do one radio broadcast a week. I actually make these radio broadcasts. I don't know why I'm telling you this. I actually make these radio broadcasts a month at a time. Due to my schedule, I have to do that. And so normally I take one day of the month, make all the radio broadcasts for that one month. So anyway, our broadcasts usually air days, weeks after that we've recorded them. So sometimes we get a little bit discombobulated as far as where we're at and those kind of things. But anyway, we're in Psalm 23, a great psalm in the Bible. The Bible says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Lord Jesus, we love you. We thank you for this great day. We thank you for this open door that you've given us. I pray you'll help us today to be a blessing and a help to your people. And we'll thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, we've been talking about, we ended last week's broadcast, and we're talking about, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." And we learned from the Bible that to want was to lack. We also learned from the Bible in James chapter 1 and verse number 2, the Bible says, "My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into divers temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. But let patience have her perfect work, that ye may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing." Or we're not changing the Bible, we're simply using the definition we learned from the Bible, or lacking nothing. And so, "With the Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing that I will lack." And then we went through the verses, verse 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 of Psalm 23. We mentioned some things there, that because the Lord is our shepherd, we should not lack those things. We talked about rest, restoration, right path, reassurance, refreshment. Then we started doing a comparison with Psalm 34, and we learned in Psalm 34, verse number 9. Now we read a lot more of that psalm, but verse number 9 particularly, it says, "Oh, fear the Lord, ye his saints, for there is no want to them that fear him." And so we learned from the Lord, verse 11. We learn from verse number 9 that one's fear of the Lord will cause us to not lack or to want. Now, that's kind of an odd comparison if you think about it, and certainly not something that you would come up with in leaning to your own understanding. But it is because of the fear of the Lord that we shall not lack or that we shall not want. And so we talked about some things from that Psalm 34. Because in verse number 11, it says, "Come ye children, hearken unto me, I will teach you the fear of the Lord." And so we don't have to lean to our own understanding as to what the fear of the Lord is. The Bible teaches us plainly what the fear of the Lord is. And so We talked about a few of those things. We talked about desiring what is good. Amen. The fear of the Lord will cause you to desire what is good. The fear of the Lord will cause you to speak what is true. And may the Lord help us to desire that which the Lord desires for us. May the Lord help you and I to speak that which is pleasing to the Lord. And it will also cause us to pursue what is right. And that's where we got to. And so that's where we need to take up on today's broadcast. In Psalm 34, verse 14, we're talking about the latter part of Psalm 23, verse number 1. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Now, Psalm 34, verse 14 says, depart from evil and do good, seek peace and pursue it. So this means that we are to be abandoning sin once and for all. We are, let's stop waiting for a sign, stop waiting for a good time, if you will, and just start abandoning sin right now and depart from evil and do good, amen. We have God's word that that is the right thing to do. Psalm 37, verse 27, we see a similar passage. Depart from evil and do good and dwell forevermore. And so, husbands, stop waiting for your wife to do right. You do right. Wives, stop waiting for your husband to depart from evil and you do right. You just go ahead and depart from evil and do right yourself. Same with church members, same with siblings, same with parents and children and parents. Listen, you as an individual, stop waiting on someone else and you start right now doing that which is pleasing to God and departing from evil. Proverbs 3, verse number 7 says, be not wise in thine own eyes. Look, here it is again. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. Listen, we cannot make decisions in our life based on how we see things. We certainly cannot base decisions in our life on how we feel about things. We base those decisions on our fear of the Lord and our intent to depart from evil. Now, this is exactly where we got to. Proverbs 8, verse 13. The fear of the Lord is to hate evil, pride, and arrogance, and the evil way and the froward mouth do I hate. Now, contrary to popular opinion and contrary to religious rhetoric, there are things that the Lord hates. Amen? He hates pride, he hates arrogance, he hates the evil way, and he hates the froward mouth. Now, the word froward means to be ungovernable or not governable. There's no ability to govern a froward mouth. And so the Bible here defines evil far differently than what you and I would define as evil. The Bible defines pride as evil. The Bible defines arrogance as evil. The Bible defines an evil way as evil. The Bible defines a froward mouth or an ungovernable mouth as evil. Now, I realize there are a lot of things that are certainly evil, and we would label those things as evil. But I think it's interesting that God's list of things that he considers evil is far more diligent than ours, or maybe it is what you and I might not necessarily consider evil, the Lord considers to be evil. Listen, we run into people with a froward mouth all the time, and we don't think all that much about that. In the eyes of the Lord, a froward mouth is an evil thing. If you can't govern your speech, friend, you're not spiritual, you're evil. And that's what the Bible says. Now, Proverbs 16 and verse 16 says this, how much better is it to get wisdom than gold, and to get understanding rather than to be chosen than silver? Now look at verse 17. The highway of the upright is to depart from evil. He that keepeth his way preserveth his soul. Now listen, this may seem funny, but I'm just trying to help you. Does your life feel like you're on a dirt road? If it does, I mean, it's just full of bumps and noise and dust and gravel banging against the car and all that. Listen, you don't know how to get rid of that. Depart from evil. If you're going against the clear teaching of Scripture and you claim to know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, Your life is a mess. The Bible says the highway of the upright is to depart from evil. I much rather travel on a highway than I had a dirt road, amen. And so if you want to travel the highway, get off of the dirt road, then you must depart from evil. Romans 12:9 says this, let love be without dissimulation. That's hypocrisy. Let love be without dissimulation. Abhor that which is evil. Cleave to that which is good. Now, we mentioned a moment ago, there's things we consider and we say that are evil, and they are. But when you think about it, in light of Proverbs 8 that we just read just a moment ago, then we should hate that which is evil. We should hate pride. We should hate arrogance. We should hate the evil way, and we should hate the froward mouth. And we should cleave to that which is good. Now, you say, preacher, I hate evil. I hate alcohol. I hate drugs. I hate homosexuality. I hate fornication. I hate adultery. Listen, you don't hate those things if you're allowing them in your living room. You see, there's so many people, they claim to be believers. They claim to be Christians. I'm not saying they're not. They claim to be against all of these things. And then they go sit down with their family and with their children. And in their own living room, they watch drunkenness on TV. They watch fornication on their television. They watch adultery on their television. They watch all of these things. And they're soaking these things in their own living room. They're very tolerant of the very evil that they say that they hate. And listen, they're so tolerant to these things that they don't mind their children and their family being taught such behavior from their own living room. Listen, I am sick to death of hearing parents say, I don't know what happened to my kids. I raised them in church. No, you didn't raise them in church. You raised them in your living room. You raised them in your house. And if you were faithful, you visited church 1, 2, or 3 times a week. They were raised in your home, amen. And so, listen, the Bible says in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse number 19, nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his, and let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. Listen, if you're not willing, as a believer, to depart from the iniquity, the Bible has a verse for that as well. Now, we're talking about, you say, preacher, we're a long way from Psalm 23. No, we're not. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. The reason there are so many wants in our life is because we refuse to fear the Lord and depart from evil. Now, I mentioned, if you're a believer and you refuse to depart from evil, look what the Bible says. The Bible says in Proverbs 13, verse number 19, the desire accomplished is sweet to the soul, but it is abomination to fools to depart from evil. Now listen, I want to put this in plain Carroll County, Cana, Virginia language. I say that because that's where our church is at. You are a fool if you do not depart from evil. And you say, preacher, you're not supposed to call people a fool. I'm just repeating to you what the Bible says in this passage of Scripture. You are a fool if you claim to be a believer and you refuse to depart from evil. Now listen, don't get mad at the preacher. I simply read to you what the Bible has to say. I simply read to you what the Scripture says concerning those who refuse to depart from evil. Now, that verse of Scripture, it goes all the way back to Psalm 34. We're all the way back in Psalm 34, verse 14. And we're talking about pursuing what is right. And we can't pursue what is right if we're continuing to do that which is evil. You can't. A double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. You can't do both, amen. And so depart from evil and do good, seek peace and pursue it. So we depart from evil and do good. Listen, doing good as God gives us the strength and ability to do so, God wants us to be honest. We need to be an honest, moral, upright human being that can be trusted and respected. Depart from evil, do good, seek peace. Here's a question for you. Are you a peacemaker or a troublemaker? Now, you say, preacher, I'm not a troublemaker. Yeah, but are you a peace seeker? You see, There are a lot of folks, a lot of times, we're not troublemakers. We have no desire to start trouble. I know, but are you interested in seeking peace? Are you interested in making peace? So we're to depart from evil, we're to do good, we are to seek peace. That means when things are not peaceful, we seek to make them peaceable. The Bible says in Romans 12, verse 18, if it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. Now, this verse of Scripture gives some latitude, if you will. We learn from this verse of Scripture that there are going to be times that it will not be possible, it will be impossible to live peaceably with some people. However, the Bible also tells us, as much as lieth in you, that means you have made every attempt in yourself. You have made every attempt with the help of God. You have made every attempt to live peaceably with that individual before you determine the fact that it is impossible to do so. So, listen, we are to seek peace now and pursue it. Pursue means that we have to work at it. With the help of the Lord, we have to work at it. Sometimes our best effort seems to be in vain, but at least we obeyed the Lord by pursuing it, by seeking it, that we may have peace. Now, so to fear the Lord, there is a desire. We desire what is good. We speak what is true. We pursue what is right. Now, we're continuing to talk about what it means to fear the Lord because there's no way that we can shall not want if we don't fear the Lord. We learned that from Psalm 34, verse number 9. Here's number 4. We can expect what is best. Look at verse 15. If we fear the Lord, we can expect what is best. Psalm 34, verse 15. The eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and his ears are open unto their cry. The face of the Lord is against them that do evil, to cut off the remembrance of them from the earth. Listen, the Lord is watching over you, and he still hears your cry. We should stop living in fear. We should stop living in worry. We should stop living in doubt. Listen, some of you won't have anything to do, anything good to say. Some of you wouldn't have anything good to say if you were in the very presence of the Lord. Listen, that doesn't sound like someone who shall not want. The Lord has his eye on you. The Lord has his eye on me. He will hear you when you cry to him. He'll hear me when we cry to him. And so God help us to expect what is best. Listen, if you want to continue to live in evil, the Bible says something about that too in those verses that we just read. If you want to continue to live evil, the face of the Lord is against you. Listen, I don't want the face of the Lord against me. I know that. I don't have any problem with that. I know I don't want the face of the Lord against me. Psalm 34, 17 says, the righteous cry and the Lord heareth and delivereth them out of all their troubles. The Lord is nigh unto them that are of a broken heart and saveth such as be of a contrite spirit. So listen, it's time we get brokenhearted over sin. We don't have much trouble being brokenhearted over somebody else's sin. And I think it's a good thing. It's a great thing as believers for you and I to be brokenhearted over someone else's sin. But when's the last time you're brokenhearted over your sin? If we would get brokenhearted, if we would be brokenhearted over our own sin, it would cause us to strive to do that which is pleasing to the Lord. The Bible says in verse number 19, many are the afflictions of the righteous. And so we should just go ahead and accept the fact that there's going to be afflictions. There's going to be problems. There's going to be trouble. However, that verse doesn't stop. You know, Psalm 34, 19, many are the afflictions of the righteous. Man, if the verse ended right there, it would be truth. But what a blessing that it doesn't end there, because the verse goes on to say, but the Lord delivereth him out of them all. And so there are afflictions, but the Lord is the deliverer, amen. Verse 20 says, he keepeth all his bones, not one of them is broken. Evil shall slay the wicked, and they that hate the righteous shall be desolate. The Lord redeemeth the soul of his servants, and none of them that trust in him shall be desolate. What do you get from that, preacher? Those who fear the Lord need fear nothing else. Did you get that? Those that fear the Lord need fear nothing else. Listen, here's why. That fear drives out all fear. That brings us right back to the psalm that we're studying. Psalm 23, verse number 1, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Want, lacking. So listen, what are you lacking? True satisfaction makes poor men rich. Listen. I don't say many things that are worth keeping. I understand that, but listen to this. True satisfaction makes poor men rich, and dissatisfaction makes rich men poor. And so, the Lord is my shepherd, and for that reason alone, I shall not want. He's enough. He's all I need. Listen, I could find plenty to whine about. I could find plenty to complain about. People ask me all the time, and it's a conversation starter. I understand that. How's it going, preacher? How's life treating you? Everything good? Listen, I could take that time to give them a whole list of complaints. I could take that time to give them a whole list of problems. I could take that time and give them a whole list of difficulties and afflictions that all of us are going through. Or, as I try to do, I try, with the help of the Lord, always say, everything's fine, everything's great. You say, preacher, that's a lie. No, it's not. Because the Lord is my shepherd. And in all reality, I shall not want. He's enough. Amen. And so, listen, praise the Lord for that. So, you say those things and someone will say, well, listen, is dissatisfaction ever good? Is dissatisfaction ever good? Yeah, there are absolutely times when dissatisfaction is a good thing. Listen, I am not satisfied with our past achievements of the Lord. Just this month, the Lord has allowed me to celebrate 20 years as the pastor of Bear Trail Baptist Church. It may not be anything to you. It may not mean nothing to you. And if it doesn't, that's okay. But it means a lot to me. The Lord has allowed us to see a lot of wonderful things accomplished. The Lord has allowed us to do many great things that I never thought we would in a million years that we'd be able to accomplish or be able to do. But listen, I don't want to be satisfied with the past 20 years. I'm thankful for those 20 years. Those 20 years were wonderful. Those 20 years were a blessing. We learned and we grew. And in fact, I look back to when I started and I'm embarrassed at where I was at spiritually. I'm embarrassed at where I was at as far as being separated. I'm embarrassed where I was at with so many things way back there when I started. But I am thankful for all the things the Lord allowed us to accomplish. But if I am satisfied with what the Lord has allowed us to do, I am never going to do more. I want to do more. Listen, I'm tired of running into Christian people. And the only thing that they can talk about is what they've done. I'm glad for what they did. What are you doing? Is there any present fruit? We're thankful for your past accomplishments. We're grateful for what you've contributed in the past. What are you doing now? There are so many has-been workers. There are so many used-to-be doers. What are you doing now? You know why you're not doing anything now? Because you're satisfied with what you've already done. I don't want to be so satisfied with what's been accomplished that I'm no present good or no future good for the cause of Christ. May God help you and I to be dissatisfied with what we're doing now or what we can do in the future. You say, preacher, can you give me some Bible for that? Oh, I would love to give you some Bible for that. Paul, that's exactly what Paul stressed in Philippians chapter 3. Look there, if you will. Philippians 3, verse 13. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Now, you can read that passage of Scripture and you can say, oh, well, Paul's talking about forgetting his sin. He's talking about forgetting his religion. He's talking about forgetting his persecution of Christians. Okay, I'm not going to argue with you. But I think this, verse is far deeper than that. I think Paul is saying, forgetting those things which are behind. I had all of these missionary journeys. I started all of these churches. God allowed me to write all of these books of the Bible. I've done all of these things, but I'm not content. I'm not satisfied. I'm pressing forward to the mark. There's more to be accomplished. There's more to do for the glory of God. And so I am so afraid that there's so many people, so many good people, so many Christian people, so many believers, and they're satisfied. They're so satisfied with their current spiritual condition that they are doing nothing right now for the Lord Jesus Christ. So when do we get satisfied, and when do we stop growing in the Lord? Dissatisfaction is a great motivator to improve our life and to improve our walk with Christ. May we learn to know Christ and walk closer to our shepherd each day. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. I shall not lack. What a great blessing. Verse number two, Psalm 23, verse number two. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. Now, in this verse, we see the peace and the refreshment of the sheep. Now, if what I've read about sheep is true, I have never owned a sheep. I've never tended sheep. I've never had any dealings with sheep, hardly at all whatsoever. But I have read a lot about sheep in the past. And if what I have read about sheep is true, it is almost impossible to get a sheep to lie down and rest unless four requirements are provided or met in order for them to seek rest. Here they are. Number one, they refuse to rest unless they are free from panic. Now, let me put it, a sheep will not lay down and a sheep will not rest if they are completely free from panic. Listen, dear Christian friend, you're listening to the sound of my voice today and your life is in chaotic panic. You have no spiritual rest. You have no physical rest. Listen, this world is a chaotic mess. I promise you it is. I know that it is. And listen, oftentimes we're the same way. People, we can't rest. As believers, we can't rest if we're afraid or worried about family and friends and finances and the feelings of others and the future and all those kind of things. Listen, God doesn't want us to be living in constant fear. In fact, the Lord has not even given us the spirit of fear. The Bible says in 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse number 7, it says, "For God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind." So listen, friend, if we are struggling in this area, we may have strayed too far from the shepherd. We need some rest, friend. Now, second of all, four things must be provided in order for a sheep to have rest. First of all, they refuse to rest unless they're free from panic. Second of all, they refuse to rest unless they are free of problems with other sheep. Did you hear that? They refuse to rest unless they are free of problems with other sheep. They can't rest if they're having constant conflicts with other sheep in the flock. Ain't that an amazing thing? I don't even have to preach that point. You know exactly where that point is going. You and I don't rest well either if we're having conflicts with others, especially if we're having conflicts with those in our own family or those in our church family. That's the truth of the matter. Well, my time, it always ends at an inappropriate time, but nonetheless, the church pays for 30 minutes. 30 minutes is all we get. So our time is quickly coming and going again today. May God bless you till we meet again is our prayer. Thank you, thank you, thank you, social media outlet. Sometimes I think we are reaching almost as many people now on our Facebook and YouTube page as we are the radio and the internet. So thank you for your help. Thank you for watching, listening, sharing, all of those things. Please continue to do that. That's a great blessing to this preacher. It's a great blessing to this ministry. And this is one outlet where there is no way that you can reach more people unless people help you. So thank you. I'm not asking for your money. We don't need that, thankfully. Praise the Lord. I'm asking you to share the broadcast so we can reach more people. Thank you. God bless you is our prayer.